So we're going to talk about the information age, which we're in right now. The age of innovation, breakthroughs, high technologies, information, the internet, just-in-time, computers, fiber optic cables, and whether any of that's any good or not. So what I first wanted to look at is, I took a couple of fields for us to investigate, you know, where we came from, like where we get the modern technologies that we have today. So first off, medicine. People can name some, let's write up a list of some of the breakthroughs we've had in medicine.
Penicillin?
Okay. Okay. Anything else?
Aspirin?
Okay, that's a pretty good one.
What was the question?
What are the breakthroughs that we've had in medicine?
Morphine?
Okay.
Anesthesia,
all right.
Antidepressants?
Did you say penicillin?
Yeah, that's number one. Antidepressant.
AIDS cocktails.
Okay.
So now we're getting into a bunch of medicines.
Yeah, we're getting into specific medicines.
Blood transfusion.
Okay, blood. No, it's in the field of medical care. Okay. Anything that's related to medicine.
Open heart surgery.
Yeah, there you go. Open heart surgery.
Okay.
X-rays.
X-rays. Okay.
CAT scan.
Okay.
Ultrasound.
All right.
That's good for me.
Insulin. That's a great one. Before you had diabetes, too bad, nothing you can do about it.
Organ transplant.
Organs, okay. Let me see if I...
Viagra count.
What's that?
I knew you were going to say that.
Very nice. Okay. Well, how about EKGs? Or ECGs, depending on how you like to call them.
What are EKGs, dude?
Electrocardiograms. Just measuring your heart rate, heart signals and things. Medical marijuana. Yeah, sure. Why not?
Pot.
Viagra.
Allegra. Breakthroughs in medicine.
Oh, we got breakthroughs. Hold on a minute. I don't know.
Yeah, pot always existed.
Oh, okay.
That's
yeah.
Not a
opium. About that. Opium. Okay, that's true. Well, we get morphine. That's close enough for now, right?
Mm-hmm.
How about polio vaccine? Before the polio vaccine, you wouldn't go to swimming pools. You wouldn't. You could communicate it, and it killed you, and it could kill you. This is the big stuff. Like the SARS scares we have now, polio. And one other thing I thought it was catheters.
Oh, yeah.
You know, to go up and like clear your heart out, or take cameras up inside, or use the balloons to kind of push your arteries back open, things like that. So that's a lot of. There's a lot here. Okay. The germ theory of disease.
How do you say the mini camera?
I'm sorry, catheter. A catheter is any of these things that they stick in somewhere that just goes up and gets you.
Catheter. Where did that technology come
from? We're going to get into all of that, actually. We got germs, the whole idea of germs, and Louis Pasteur. And before this, the idea that you actually had microbes that caused disease wasn't really around. And so Pasteur came up with that, and also vaccines. Now, let's kind of look at when all these things happened. Because, you know, this is the information age, the age of breakthroughs, right? So, we must have, if this is the best stuff we can come up with, right up to Viagra and medical marijuana and Allegra. Let's see when these things happened. Penicillin, anybody know when this came up?
The 1910s.
It was discovered in 1929. It was in the 40s, during the war, that it was really mass-produced. They really mastered the ability to really make penicillin in a big scale.
Was it by Americans or what?
I'm not sure exactly where it was developed, either here or Britain, I think. It was originally found in Britain.
Aspirin's older than that,
all right? When's aspirin from? Before they could get you well, they could just take the pain away.
1900s. 1900s.
1889. This is actually a German thing. German morphine is also kind of similar era.
Oh yeah, that's right, Bayer.
Yeah, Bayer. Like I don't know if people know this, but heroin, that was a trademark, just like aspirin, of the Bayer company.
Right.
And so the Germans, you know, Bayer was a German company. The Treaty of Versailles took away heroin and aspirin from the Germans. That was part of the agreements, the Treaty of Versailles at the end of World War I. They took their patents to these medicines.
Oh, wow.
No. Anesthesia. This came from a dentist in
Connecticut
in the year
1846. No way!
Close.
No, it's really old. It is really old. Yeah, yeah.
I'm in 1940.
Never
mind. This one is really working. I mean, a lot of breakthroughs were made in the 1940s also.
Is it the same sort of mixture?
It was ether and stuff like that, but people knew about laughing gas back then. People used nitrous oxide even back then. As far as like the really good stuff, you usually get a shot now. It's not just, you know, shh. That is more advanced, and a lot of work on that was done in the 1940s. Around the war, because there's a lot of surgery going on. When wartime can be a great push for medicines. Okay, antidepressants, AIDS cocktails. I guess these are from the 90s, right?
Back in the
80s. Did these begin really?
AIDS
it's some good stuff.
1980s. Say
late 80s.
Yeah.
Antidepressants were probably in the late 60s, mid to late 60s. I don't know.
It'd be good if we really knew. But it wasn't in 1930 or anything, right?
I don't know.
Blood transmission, blood transfusion, I mean. Anyone know when that was from?
I
don't look all these things up.
1930?
Well, we don't really know. Okay, let's see. How about open heart? Open heart surgery? Does anyone know when that first
70s.
Happened? That was in the 70s?
I knew so.
Okay.
Oh, Charles Drew developed blood transfusion.
Okay.
He knows it was in the 40s.
40s? Okay. All right, 1940s. Again, wartime, post-war, Hilberton type era. X-rays.
Early 1900s. 50s.
Well, 1894 is when Roentgen, or how do you say his name, Roentgen or whatever, he first, you know, made some, made some tests with it. The CAT scan is from 1975. Mm-hmm. I don't really know when X-rays first really got particularly good. The CAT scan 1975 coming out of the space program. Ultrasound?
Same 70s.
Yeah, out of the space program also, yeah. So we could get a space program. Maybe they came a little later, but that's what generated them.
Insulin.
Insulin, yeah. Combined insulin.
30s?
1922, actually. Although methods for making it better took a long, it probably got advanced in the 40s. Because the way they first get it, you have to get like, you know, a pig pancreas to get the insulin out of it.
Yeah,
yeah, it was.
A what kind of pancreas?
I think a pig or a sheep. No, sheep. I think they'd use a sheep pancreas for it.
Should they use
pig? I don't really know. One or the other. Sheep. Anyway, not a big deal compared to how it's made today, where they use a. Probably guess they use bacteria to make it today.
Make what?
Insulin. When you get diabetes, is when you can't regulate your blood sugar. And so they used the insulin helps you manage your body, your blood sugar. And other breakthroughs are simple things like the little finger prickers. Because before that, you had to just take biscuit and knife, cut your arm off to get a blood sample if you had diabetes to get sugar tests. And people just wouldn't do that. So people, you know, before that, something as simple as that. Organs, anybody know?
Just started.
70s.
I don't really know. It's not the 90s. EKG, 1924. I imagine in Germany, this is why it's K for cardio with a K in German. Polio, when did Salk come up with the polio vaccine?
Who came up with it?
40s.
Salk, S-A-L-K.
1940s?
Franklin Roosevelt had polio.
Oh, sorry. Oh, 1950.
52, and then it was really the mass inoculation in the United States started in 54. Okay. Catheter, balloon catheter was 1963. There were other catheters named before this.
How did Roosevelt
survive
polio?
He was paralyzed. I mean, it eats at your nervous system. That's why his legs didn't work anymore. But I guess it just stopped there. You know, it didn't go any farther. But, you know, it can't. I mean, people with these iron lungs, you've seen it in the movie or pictures of it, people in these big, like, iron lung things. That's because they had polio, and it eats away at your nervous system, and paralyzes you. And this is just something you could get by coughing on people, something that can completely paralyze you and kill you, or need you make you live in some big, you know, have a life support system for the rest of your life. Just get it by going to a pool, you know. So this was 54 as they got rid of this. Germs and Pasteur. Had a couple things. I'll write down a couple dates for him. Back in 1864, he came up with pasteurization. of foods. Because when you heat foods to kill all the bacteria in it. So, same thing, germ theory of disease. He knew there were things he was killing. And in 1885, he gave the first successful treatment for rabies.
Yeah, when you said for food, do they do that with all food, like meats and stuff like
food?
That?
Food? No, no, no.
Or just dairy?
Generally, it's liquids. I mean, some pasteurized cheeses, you can do it with the milk, pasteurized fruit juices. No, not meats. With meats, we've got food irradiation. That's another thing to write up, actually. Food irradiation. Like a nuclear symbol. Okay, so food irradiation. This is from the 60s. We've been able to do this in the 60s. The American Medical Association says it's a good idea. The WHO says it's a good idea. 40 countries are doing it. We're not doing an awful lot. But you can do that with meats and eggs and things like that. You can radiate it. So, I think that's probably, there's one other.
Oh, what about the pill?
Oh, yeah. What is that from?
The 60s? 50s?
I imagine this. I think the 60s. I don't really know. Anybody know?
What?
Birth control?
Birth control pills?
No, that's older.
Where's Bob?
That part of the Roaring Twins?
Hey, Bob. I mean, Charlie. how about the pill, the birth control pills? When did that come out?
I don't know.
Bob gave that class. No.
Bob gave that class?
Oh, I guess it was in the 70s or 60s or so.
Well, here's one other thing that I don't think people thought about. How about DDT? Half a billion people between 300 million and half a billion people in the world, that's, you know, say an eighth of the world, every year. An eighth of the world every year can show, no, it's not. No, it's more like a 15th or something. A 16th of the world every year contracts malaria.
Every year?
300, 500 million cases a year. Yeah. It's a lot of malaria. Now, in the 1940s, we treated it. We had DDT. We killed mosquitoes. Malaria disappeared. And 90% of the cases come from Africa. So, okay, so now let's look at what happened here. What's the last date we see up here? Oh, okay, what you... How about Allegra? Okay, Allegra was like 2001 or something.
Well, there are other things. There's like babies, Siamese twins being able to be separated, and things like this is all new. Like a lot of these special... seemingly specialized things. Sex change operation.
Sex change?
That's it.
I'm sure that's pretty recent, right?
That's it.
But I would say things like separating Siamese twins and...
Well, sex change, how about that?
Can you make
80s?
Like
80s.
Octotary?
80s, 90s, something like that. 80s, 90s.
How the hell?
You know,
because they made a big deal about those Brazilian Siamese twins.
How about Viagra?
Was
that
Buzzy
Wood?
Oh, I guess. That was maybe 10 years.
Late 90s.
Early 90s? Medical marijuana? Or is it initially
that's weird.
Now.
But I mean, the point of saying it's a medical breakthrough. I mean,
medical
I think this
marijuana
is...
now.
Alright. So,
that's so garbage.
There's nothing here in the last. About 30 years besides Viagra, Allegra. Changing your sex and smoking pot. Oh, antidepressants. I mean, this might have been.
Oh, yeah.
These have made leaps and bounds.
That's
I mean, Prozac, you know, you got all sorts of new ones now, right? Ritalin.
Zoloft.
All right.
They're so developed that they have antidepressants.
We're getting everybody's drug history here. So the point is, we're always using
No, it's true. Like, you take antidepressants, and then you get. You get too high, and then you have to take your antidepressant.
Well, 80s, 90s, antidepressants. So we got sex change, pot, Viagra, Allegra, Ritalin, Prozac, Zoloft. These are the new things for the information age.
Oh wait, what about the internet?
I don't know if that was much of a medical breakthrough.
Yeah, because you can go on a whole bunch of medical advice sites.
Yeah, that's
internet,
true.
And you can,
you can do surgery
advice.
Online. The doctor can be like on vacation.
I don't
somewhere.
Think that's very wise.
You can't do that, but you can get like advice.
Okay,
you can
ask.
Go on. You can find out about any symptoms. You can go on and say, okay, I have warts.
AskJeeves.com. Okay.
AskJeeves.
All right. So that's a medical breakthrough. All right. Well, what is going on here? Nothing's happened in the past 30 years. What are some of the things we've still got? Cancer?
AIDS, malaria again,
Black Plague,
SARS, West Black Nile Plague virus. Is coming back up, the West Nile virus,
Ebola. Tuberculosis,
Ebola. There's no cure for hepatitis. There's no vaccine for Hep C.
Yeah.
And the other ones don't work all that well.
Yeah, there's a bunch of
hepatitis.
A
and B, you can get vaccines.
I got one, but
you might have got both. Probably B, I guess, got one. Anyway, so you got...
worms.
Okay. You can kill worms.
Yeah, they kill you, though.
Don't, we have medicine still.
Okay.
All right, so... we haven't done anything in the past. So what happened? Well, why did we stop making breakthroughs? What happened?
We're all better.
We're all better.
Yeah, we reached the end of medicine.
Yeah. No.
Even though people don't have hospitals, we reached the end of medicine. Shutting down the hospitals. At least you got your leg, or don't worry about it. Yeah, your Prozac is a lot. He needs a hospital.
The market doesn't.
But I mean, what happened? I mean, what changed?
It's a paradigm shift.
What massive policy in healthcare occurred?
HMOs.
1973. There's a big breakthrough.
Oh, yeah.
On the malaria front, 1972. DDT is banned. We stopped building nuclear plants. They haven't had much since the CAT scan, MRI. They're kind of making a few little adjustments with these things, but it's 70s technology. That's Kennedy-era technology. 1971. Bretton Woods ended. The new era began. Right? It started in the 60s. So, we're not advancing. We're not advancing in the medical field. The diseases are. There's more and more bacteria that are resistant to antibiotics. You gotta use, more and more rare, brand new kinds of antibiotics to kill them. But we're really not making that many new ones, We got a few great ones that work for now. But we're already finding cases of tuberculosis, for example, that no antibiotic is gonna kill. Or maybe just only one antibiotic will work against it. What happens when that gets out? Keep out of a hospital if you don't need to be there, by the way. That's where you find these things, in hospitals. Not to scare anybody, but, I mean, that's...
Oh, yeah, exactly.
Well, no, this is scary stuff.
Like you hit by a damn
so what else do we have left? We still got AIDS. Lyndon was not listened to in the 80s. We have not cured AIDS. Not much going on in the cancer front, really. Some stuff's going on, but not really.
Isn't it possible, though, if you have an awful lot of money to just stay alive with all these things?
No.
Yeah,
you've got cancer and metastasized, it doesn't matter how much money you got. They can't do anything about it. And my grandfather just died recently. He had all the money he could possibly want for any sort of treatment. After a while, it just doesn't work. You're getting old. Your body's not that strong anymore. You can give radiation here and chemo this and all that, but they're not new principles. No, you can't do it.
When did chemotherapy come about?
I don't know. I don't know when that came from. Although I imagine the radiation treatment was, probably after the space era, probably earlier. I mean, this is when the technology that it's based on came about. It's when the underlying fundamentals for any of these things really stopped in the 60s. And we had some spillover into the 70s of CAT scans, ultrasound, some stuff that came out of the space program, which was still alive to some extent then. But really, look at this, 40s, a lot came up in the war. Penicillin being done really well. Anesthesia was much more developed in the 1940s. Blood transfusions, much more developed in the 1940s. DDT, being widely used in the 1940s, they cut the cases in Sri Lanka from 3 million to 17 for a number of years of cases of malaria, just gone. And I imagine this is when more work was done on insulin, too, because you really couldn't make it quite that well in the 20s yet. You couldn't master, you still had these, pancreases and things. So what we've seen is we had a paradigm shift, that they said this is the beginning of a new era. It was the last revolution. We're ready to go. We're going to make money. Well, let's look through one more example real quick. Is it really debatable? I mean, we're clearly not advancing in the medical field. Not like we have. Not like we did after World War II under the Hill-Burton system. Not like we did before we introduced HMOs. We just said, make money. Don't have teaching hospitals. So I'm going to go ahead and... Oh, Shauna wants to be on the class. I think this is her, probably. Oh. Hello? Hi, who's this? That's the wrong number. Alright.
You have a number?
Yeah.
You're supposed to call her cell phone or something?
Yeah, yeah. It's a Saturday. Alright. Oh, we did have, remember, maybe we'll leave up the breakthroughs that we did make. What's the breakthroughs we made are hot. That's big off when we get the Viagra.
Allegra.
Allegra. Allegra. So you don't have to have a runny nose.
Crack in the 80s.
Crack on. Okay, Ritalin.
Zoloft.
If you don't like what's going on, just forget about it. It's a summer holiday. Zoloft. That is a pretty terrible thing.
Ritalin.
Alright, so look, that's... So basically, this is a breakthrough. This is the information era breakthroughs. And pot is not exactly a new discovery.
Hello, Sean.
So how about another one? How about cars?
You want to be on this class?
Don't we have, like, awesomely fancy cars now? You got the Escalade going down the street. You got the H2 Hummer, right? All these new technologies, right?
GPS.
Yeah.
So let's look at... So people didn't... I don't even know people even know about cars. What advancements have been made in cars?
Nitro boosters.
Nitro boosters. Kind of say supercharger. Is that okay?
Yeah.
That's a supercharger. I know it's different. I don't want to say supercharger. I need to know when that was made.
We have the
combustion engine.
Okay, internal combustion.
Okay.
As opposed to a steam engine.
Anti-lock brakes.
Yeah. Airbags.
Seatbelts. Anti-lock brakes. Seatbelt.
Rearview mirrors.
Airbags.
I said that.
Airbag. Hold on. Really? Seatbelt?
Yeah,
said that too.
Yeah, you wrote it.
Raver stickers.
Airbag. What's some of rear view mirror? Do you know when that came around?
Mirror.
That'd be up on the highway.
Mirror.
No?
Let me see. What else?
I mean, it didn't take a lot of thinking to put one on. I mean, probably maybe on horse carriages.
I don't know. Moving to cleaner burning fuel. Moving from leaded gasoline to unleaded and reducing emissions. The process of reducing emissions.
Okay, actually, you're right. There's actually been a lot done on emissions reduction.
What about the donut?
What do you call that?
Catalytic converter.
Well, see, some of these are recirculation.
Don't forget the donor.
Automatic transmission.
Okay. Transmission. What was the other one someone else just said?
The donut.
Catalytic converter.
Oh, catalytic converter. A donut.
Power steering.
What's that?
A tiny little spare in the trunk instead of a full-size spare.
Four-wheel drive.
I said that. Boo.
They take away the big tire and put in a little.
Anything else? What else do we look for?
Power wheels.
Power wheels?
Windows.
Oh, power windows. Okay.
Power wheel.
It's more like an amenity.
Well, whatever. Something
CD happened. Players.
Radio? I mean, once you have a radio, TV? You know, CD player is probably not too big a difference, right?
TV? There's plenty. No, there's plenty.
TVs?
They do turn signals. Well,
no.
How about AC?
Oh, yeah.
I think turn signals are important.
You can just roll the window.
Hey,
can
you put your hand
on
the signals?
Not if you're driving Ricky's car.
No.
Oh, yeah.
How about disc brakes?
Subwoofer.
How about disc brakes?
Subwoofers.
Doesn't that go along with anti-lock braking system?
No, it was developed before.
How did brakes work before that?
The way that most cars don't have four-wheel disc brakes. My car does. It's got the front wheels, they have discs, they get pinched. The other one's kind of like, got a drum. Well, it doesn't matter. It's too detailed for now. Okay, how about fuel injection?
Oh, yeah.
Nice. You don't want that dirty old, what is that, the carburetor thing? You have fuel injection going on?
I mean, any of us know what that means. I mean, it's all right.
Oh, really?
GPS. Like one of those man.
What about shocks?
Diesel
injection.
Shocks. Diesel engines get some better gas mileage.
True,
good shocks.
No one does it that way.
The carburetor, you're bouncing around, breaking your back. And you
shocks. I thought
the fuel injection was so you don't have to warm up your car.
No.
Where did all these come from?
Dual exhaust.
Ooh, okay, that's probably bad enough. Well, internal combustion engine. Well, there's really a big, I mean, beyond the internal combustion engine. You also have the you got the auto cycle engine, which is what we use today. It's a four stroke system. We'll start auto. There's an automobile.
Is that how you spell it?
That's the guy's last name, Otto. He's German. Okay. He taught Daimler. Daimler worked with him.
Oh, Chrysler?
He's the one there.
Otto, is it still called an Otto engine?
The internal combustion engine?
Well, the internal combustion engine, I mean, that's really old. I mean, Huygens had an idea for internal combustion engine.
But it wasn't made until 1885, right?
No, there were other things made before that. Like, things back in, I mean, literally, from the 1700s, they used coal gas to have internal combustion. Huygens was going to use gunpowder. So, but, I mean, the invention of using gasoline for internal combustion engines, yeah, that was from later then. But let's go through some of these dates here. No, it was before the 1880s. The auto cycle, 1876.
Wow.
In 1876, you've got the four-stroke engine, which, you know, like a lawnmower doesn't have, but a car does. Four-stroke engine, 1876, this was invented. So that's pretty old. Peugeot has existed since 1891. Disc brakes, 1901. Okay, your four-wheel disc brakes, okay, that's a century old. What else do we have? Power windows.
Anybody got a guess?
52.
1948?
No.
Oh,
way.
Hell no.
Oh, actually, that makes sense.
Radio. When did you get that radio put in there?
50.
1929.
Oh, my God.
Supercharger. When did the supercharger hit the scene?
60s.
Whoa.
Well,
anti-lock brakes. I don't really know.
80s?
I forgot about anti-lock brakes.
1912.
Yeah, that's the 80s.
Seatbelt.
20s.
Shoulder belt came in 1954 by Volvo.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, airbags.
80s.
Yeah, these were in the 80s. That's true.
I remember the ABS came out in the 80s.
80s? Okay. Mirror, I mean, you know.
1920.
1200, I don't know. Supercharger is when it pushes extra air into the engine. So maybe it
supercharges.
It supercharges.
Oh, somebody's amazing. Knocking at the door. And...
Hello. Hey. We're just talking about cars. Actually, we're just talking about where discoveries went. What's your name?
Hashtag.
Okay.
There's a camera right there.
Oh my gosh.
They're watching you look out. Yeah, the FBI insisted on putting it in. What you missed is we were just going through, like, you know how we're in the new information era now? And we've got breakthroughs and new technologies and computers that fit inside your thumbnail and things like this? So we just went through medicine. And we're going through all the breakthroughs in medicine and healthcare. And the only things that we found that were made in the last 30 years were medical marijuana, Viagra, Allegra, Ritalin, Zoloft. None of these, even like CAT scans and MRI scans and X-rays and they put little cameras inside your blood vessels to look inside your body, like they put it in through here and it goes all into your heart or something. That's from the 60s. Anesthesia, germs, vaccines, all this is like, you know, it's old. And we've not really done that much since then besides, you know, Viagra. Now we're looking at cars. And we're seeing what kind of break? Yeah. Oh no! Don't not eating a donut in your car. We're not talking about the Krispy Kreme drive-thru. Does anyone know the year on this? This is, you know, like they got these spare tires, these wussy little things now, not full size. Does anyone know when they introduced that improvement?
1995.
1998. 1995. I mean, does anyone actually know?
That was impressive. Doesn't Lyndon talk about it in the quality adjustment factor?
70s. 70s or 80s? Yeah.
I wouldn't think that's an improvement, though.
No.
They call it an improvement.
Some people might. Don't put your opinions on other people. Unleaded gas. When did we make the switch to unleaded gas? Is it 1980 or so?
Lead was banned in the 70s.
Leaded was banned?
I remember when I was little. I thought
they still had leaded in the 70s. 1980,
what it says.
Yeah,
so unleaded gasoline. Oh, 1980. Emission controls. We've got exhaust, gas, or circulation. That's from the 90s. There's tank evaporation systems. A little bit of gas evaporates from the tank. It catches it. That's from the 90s. There's a few other things under that. Oh, pretty.
Public service.
automatic transmission, when did that come into play?
I don't know. Although they had transmissions back in the 1860s. I mean, like three-speed ones.
Really?
They weren't automatic. There weren't automatic transmissions in the 1860s.
I don't know, 50s? 40s?
Does anyone know when automatic transmissions came on the
scene? Automatic transmission? 19...
Yeah, I'd say 50s, because that's
the old time. Yeah,
50s. It seems like the...
Maybe 40s.
Move to the suburbs, get a car, you don't really have to drive.
CC, what is it? Catalytic
McCarthy
converter.
Yeah,
the catalytic converter had to come after the introduction of unleaded gas, so 1980.
Yeah,
well, lead kills catalytic converters. Alright. Donuts, power steering. When was power steering introduced?
70s.
Probably 1987.
50s.
What about cruise?
1951.
Yeah, wow. See?
4x4.
1940.
I mean, that's just, you know, that's coming back in the war, you know, we had 4x4s gone all over the place, so old.
1940. Old.
So when is this? Oh, cruise control?
When's
cruise
came
control
out of,
from?
Miami Vice.
Anyone know when cruise control came on the scene?
1940.
Does anybody know? I don't know this one. I don't know. All right. Let's get the air conditioner left. Okay, how about a fuel injection?
1966. Hello?
That's when the carburetor was on its way up. A diesel? The diesel engine was developed in 1894.
What?
Shocks? Lord knows. Differentials?
50s? I think 50s.
She'll call back. And then, how about the GPS system in your car?
90s. All right, 90s.
GPS was around a lot longer, though. Well, I mean, in a car. How about cup holders? When did cup holders come?
65.
They didn't have cup holders in all cars, did they?
9th century.
Did they have cup holders in all cars?
The feudal lords, they had their chariots.
Oh, yeah,
cup
they
holders.
Did.
They were called slaves.
Yes.
They were called the cup holders.
Hello? Air conditioning.
Okay, let me,
Now people were riding in low comfort back in the year 1940. So FDR had some AC when he was cruising around the country. So what do we have that's, what do we have, you? What do we have in the last 30 years?
We'll just pick it up on the switch on this.
No lights.
We got anti-lock brakes and airbags.
AC in 1940? No way.
Yes.
Wow.
Let's say the last 15 years. So forget unleaded gas.
What's that?
Well, y'all got some emissions control going on.
Electric car.
Electric car. How that is not a breakthrough. We had golf carts back in the, you know.
Yeah. You see what I'm saying? It's a big deal.
Catalytic converter. Same thing. Emissions control. Unleaded gas. That's all.
The last 15 years.
Donuts.
Oh yeah.
GPS.
GPS. Cruise control.
Televisions.
Viper.
Oh,
TV.
Yeah.
Spinning rims. I saw a car that someone walked near.
Oh,
and
yeah.
Step away from the car and the wheels to the rims start spinning. That's a great breakthrough.
Wells.
So spinning. Oh, how about
that?
How about hydraulics?
2001.
Hydraulics.
Or
60s.
Yeah,
okay, so hydraulics.
I mean, I'm much lower than the speed wheels.
Hydraulics.
Oh, that's
such
a
bad handwriting. All right. So, so basically we've got... Oh, yeah, it was cup holders, cruise control, the Viper, televisions.
Crumple zones.
Oh, yeah.
Crumple zones. Yeah, it's true.
So cars that break easily, they crumple zones.
No.
Well, no, they do keep you.
What is that?
That's the
FDA
accidents.
Okay, crumple glass. Mm-hmm. When's safety glass from?
That's probably a long time.
No, actually, they just...
No,
it's
what that is.
Side impact there.
Jason.
What does
that do with safety? Your windshield's not made out of safety glass. Only the side windows are.
Hello.
Is that enough? Right, we're spend
yeah, sorry about that. I got you on the speaker now. Can you hear?
Hey, we're talking about cars. Can you hear?
Yeah.
Good. Sounds kind of tentative. Okay. So we just discovered that the only things introduced in the past, say, 25 years in cars were some safety things, anti-lock brakes, airbags, crumple zones, some stuff in terms of making cars, you know, less polluting. So we got some pretty lame emissions things, to be honest. And a catalytic converter, that's pretty nice, I suppose. And then we got the GPS system, spinning rims, the Viper alarm, TVs, cup holders, cruise control.
The club, we forgot the club.
The club,
oh, yeah, that's
the
true.
Club made its appearance.
Sounds like we made an advance.
Card.
What's that thing, LoJack, whatever, the taxi car?
Oh, yeah.
They got LoJack now. Yeah, cars that, what, talking cars?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, that's true.
Cars that talk, your
no,
doors.
Automatic door opener.
Yeah,
oh, yeah,
yeah.
Star,
yeah.
Too.
Door, no,
a remote
wind, power windows are from 1948. Oh, yeah. So we got clickers.
Yeah, the door opener.
So we got clickers, all right. What else we got? The talking cars.
No, talking cars came out with that 80s show.
Oh, yeah.
Remember on
that fire?
Yeah, 80s.
Yeah.
80s, that's good enough. 80s,
that car
is
sick.
80s is the, you know, our lifetime. 80s is mine. Talking cars, probably automatic climate control.
Yeah.
Seat warmers, I don't know.
Oh, what do you call those things? Automatic
wipers?
Oh, seat pads.
I'm sure they had that. You
know, I know that.
Right. Is that
adjustable seat. All right, it's probably not that.
Okay, see.
So basically, all we got. Let's boil this down again to all only the new things. APS, airbags, you know, emission stuff, not the automatic transmission. All these fancy doodads that sit everywhere. You got your CD player, you got your clicky thing, your talking car, you got your crumple zone.
Donut.
The donut.
That's a...
They're out of plastic. My car is out of more plastic. So...
All of yours.
Not much, you know? I mean, they already had supercharged, air-conditioned, power window cars with differentials and disc brakes, radio with seatbelts, power steering, 4x4 drive. Yeah, you get about all that in 1970. So all we added was some little computers and clickers and crumple zones and emissions. Not much. Basically, it's making your car sexy, kind of like your drugs do these days. And we got plastic surgery. I forgot to include that over here. We got a top plastic surgery.
Sex change.
You can switch back and forth.
Sex change.
Yeah, actually, once you do it, it's...
I don't think you do that a lot of times. I don't really know how it works. But hopefully you don't change your mind after that. Oh, that was her. Okay. There's John. So again, we didn't make anything. Past 25 years, we got a few safety things. Some emission stuff, but frankly, we should be using less cars, and we should have some, you know, electric trains zooming around. There's nothing trains. Guess how fast a train going from Chicago to San Francisco would go back in the year 1940? How fast could that train go?
80 miles an hour.
Remember, not electric. You know, it's a diesel engine on this
80
thing.
80 miles an hour.
80? You hear anything else?
70,
price, right?
70 to 90.
40
miles per hour?
120.
120?
Was this a passenger or freight train?
It's a passenger car.
Oh,
80 miles an hour.
85.
90. You would go 90 miles an hour on a train from Chicago to San Francisco 60 years ago.
Really?
Yeah. Now, the only high-speed train we got, the electric train, the Acela, in the Northeast Corridor, can that go, I think, 110 is its max?
Yeah.
And it can't do that most of the time because it's on crappy old tracks. It's certainly never going, I was on part of it. It wasn't going that fast. So nowadays, the fastest super train we've got, it's the same train as a regular train 60 years ago. So nothing on the train front. Clickers on the car front. Viagra, sex changes, plastic surgery. You're still unhappy, you've got some Zoloft. The kids are giving you a hard time, get them some Ritalin. Get the leg or get those pesky allergies. If all else fails, just get some medical marijuana and you'll be all right. That's the breakthroughs of the past 30 years. That's the information era. So what is going wrong? What happened? One thing, we were talking about medical care. One thing was we used to not have HMOs. Used to be you got sick, you went to a hospital, they didn't even ask for your card, they took care of you, because they actually provided health care. That was the purpose of hospitals. And they said, well, let's work out the bill. You don't have any money? Okay. Well, I mean, it wasn't quite that quick, but you don't have any money? Okay, well, we're a hospital. We're a service to the public. We expect that there will be people here who can't pay. But, you know, the purpose of this nation is to provide a better standard of living for the people in it. And so we get money from the federal government, the state gives us some money, the county gives us some money. We're a non-profit, the nuns give us some money. No, don't. Okay, that's how it works.
Hey, Jason.
You're welcome.
Were the doctors back in before HMOs, were they getting paid obscene amounts of money like they are now?
Doctors really might get paid obscene amounts of money now, but they also pay obscene amounts of money. they pay for insurance costs.
Because
the insurance industry is tanking, so they're charging huge fees for But again, I mean, the doctors that make a lot of money right now, it's not your nose and throat doctors not making a fortune.
Plastic surgeons.
But yeah, exactly. When they try to make a big deal about doctors making a lot of money, it's probably either someone really, like, you know, some highly specialized brain surgeon or something, which, okay, you can understand that. There's only 10 people like you in the world, you know, maybe you can make some income. Or plastic surgeons. But family doctors, they don't make obscene amounts of money, you know. They went to school for 12 years, you know. They got student loans to pay off. It's not unreasonable to have doctors well paid. But... doctors, no, it's what's worse now under HMOs. Plus, you have to let people die if they don't want to, you know, it puts you in a moral dilemma having HMOs, where they say, you gave this person a test. I don't know if they needed that test. Our accountant says they didn't need that medical test. What do you think you are, a doctor? What's they do to doctors today? You know, they say you gave them that test, well, you have to pay for it. We're taking out of your income. You want to help people? Fine, pay for it yourself. We're not doing it. So what happened? And let's look at manufacturing. I mean, we don't make anything. Like, everybody can look at all their clothes they're wearing, and maybe we'll find, like, two articles of clothing actually made in the country.
I bet we're going to find one.
I don't think, well, so, I mean, you get, you know,
socks
are made. I really doubt socks are made in the United States. Come on, they're all from, like, Honduras and El Salvador or something like that, right? Because no one's checking the tags, huh?
That's outdoor.
Shoes, forget your shoes.
Yeah, no. Is that outdoor?
New Balance Summer? Are made in the U.S. No, by a slave somewhere.
No. But actually, New Balance factory back home.
In Maine. Okay, good. New Balance shoes are made in Maine.
Right.
But nothing here is made here. This is an old whiteboard. What's this? This is actually made in the United States, it says. This is old, though.
Honduras.
None of that's made here.
It was probably just
assembled. All these shelves. You go to IKEA. Not one thing in IKEA is made in the United States, I don't think. Your car?
Your car.
Increasingly, cars are not made in the United States. I've got a Japanese car. No.
I always buy American made.
Okay. But, well, then you're going to have to go naked because we don't make any clothes anymore.
American
made. You want food?
Mexico.
They say, yeah, this is made for America, right? Food, increasingly. We make food, but... So, what was this trade-off we made 30 years ago? We stopped making medical breakthroughs. We stopped making breakthroughs in, you know, technology. Like, you know, one example of a pretty high technology thing we use a lot is a car. I mean, it's got a lot of moving parts. It's more complicated than, you know, pens and chairs and desks and bathrooms and things like that. So you get your most high-tech thing you use in your daily life, the car. You got computers, too. What did we get?
A huge bill.
We got a huge bill. Okay, but we made this trade-off. This is about 30 years ago. The country, this is, like, we used to make things. It was about 30 years ago the shift was made, where we started saying, well, let's make less and less. We got big banks. You know, you got Bank of America existing, like, everywhere in the United States now. It took over, like, you know, 1,000 different little banks. They're all gone. We got Bank of America. So you can use your ATM, you don't have to get paid, you know, pay charges.
Right.
You know. That's a
great
thing.
Yeah, right.
You got cheap imports. Look at this. You can get cheap stuff at Marshall's now. You know? You can go to the Dollar Tree and get some cheap stuff. That's great. That's based from, yes, it's from Virginia. That's where they import the stuff. Chesapeake. So when we used to have manufacturing and growing science, we've now got the Dollar Tree. So we've got the Dollar Tree.
Got you. Okay.
The Dollar Tree, Bank of America.
Walmart.
Elvis Schmedekamp. We got Walmart.
No. Elvis went into business.
Oh, yeah, he's gone. Yeah, he's being taken
that
away.
Bank was taken over.
We've got... Well, all we got was MP3 players and...
Crap.
Fiber optics and a lot of internet porn. CD burners. Systems to, but, you know... You don't really change the ability for human beings to survive in the untamed wilderness with a CD player.
Yeah.
You know, you can make a plow, actually plow some land and make some crops, you can eat. You got your MP3 player and your Zoloft and your pot. Maybe you won't mind until you're not alive anymore. You get really upset. Yeah, you know, you get some Viagra and have some fun, yeah. So, the question of what happened in the 70s is actually the same question as why does LaRouche have so much clout? Like, why is it that... I mean, we're not on TV. We know that, right? You know, it's like some big surprise. You know, you're not on television. We know we're not on television. We're not being invited into the debate so far. Yet LaRouche's campaign, we've got more contributions than any other candidate among the Democrats. Everybody knows who LaRouche is in politics. I mean, I saw a video the other day. The California State Democratic Party had a convention in Sacramento a couple of months ago. I'll get to go to my state Democratic convention and discuss the party potluck next month when we go to the convention. Well, when you try to get in, there's 50 young LaRouche supporters outside in a picket line outside, carrying signs and banners and bullhorns, and LaRouche posters are everywhere. Like, oh, at least they made it inside. They can't be in here. Every meeting you go to, LaRouche people are in all the meetings. And by the end of the conference, you leave the room for the conference hall that you're in, because out in the hallway, there's 100 LaRouche people walking down the hallway, chanting and singing, and all the conferences just ended. Who is this guy? Well, actually, you probably know who he is, but yeah. You say to your friends, who is this? Do you know who this LaRouche person is? I've never heard of him, but he seems to be everywhere here. So, he just got back from a conference in India, where he was invited in by top people in India. The governor of the state that he went to brought him in. Imagine Gray Davis hosting somebody, you know. That's a big thing. People who were like 90 years old who fought for the independence of India hosted him. A man who was, back during the Cold War, when you had the United States and the Soviet Union, some of the neutral countries formed what was called the Non-Aligned Movement. They said, we don't want to align with the U.S. or with the Soviet Union. And for a while, India ran the Non-Aligned Movement under Prime Minister Indira Gandhi. Was actually assassinated. But the man who was the second in charge of that with her, he's still alive, and he spoke before LaRouche made his presentation. What was the kind of welcoming he got? In the past year, he's been in everywhere. France, Germany, Mexico, Brazil, Argentina very briefly. Where else? Russia.
Italy.
Poland, Ukraine. I mean Italy, and Italy, and Italy, and Italy. He goes to Italy a lot. They keep inviting him back. He went to San Marino. It's a tiny country in Italy.
Hungary.
What's that?
Hungary.
Hungary, the Hungarian Academy of Sciences, the Russian Academy of Sciences. He spoke at the Russian Parliament. We just sent a group to, well, it wasn't LaRouche. Okay, so.
No.
Yeah, in Prague.
No, we spoke in Prague, too.
Okay, well, I mean, over his lifetime, he's spoken in a lot of places. I mean, but I just mean even just in the past year or so. So, we should forget, you know, how he did that. And what that's got to do with why we don't make any more discoveries. Because I'll tell you, LaRouche represents the tradition that brought us these kinds of things, that brought us the developments that we did get. A lot of them were brought, you know, in the time around World War II and afterwards, up until 71 or so. So, let's get into how you make a discovery. Because we had to discover some things to make all these. We had to discover things about how, you know, the properties of gases condensing and evaporating for air conditioning. You know, we had to understand radio waves to make a radio. You know, power windows aren't exactly a big deal. The GPS, the technology of making the GPS, actually getting the satellites up there, so you could actually work and tell your position anywhere on the Earth, that's a big deal, you know? We had to figure out how to do that. You know, the Viper, I'm just saying that's such a big deal. But, how do we make a discovery? What are some of the biggest, just, any sort of basic discovery that man made? Gravity is a pretty common thing to hear about, right? Mm-hmm. Gravity.
Motion.
What's that?
Motion.
Motion? Mm-hmm. Anything specific about motion?
Cause of motion.
Do you have specific ones in mind or something? There's a lot of laws about how things move. I mean,
what about the thing that in your car he can tell you where you're going, you tell them you just...
Yeah, the direction finding thing?
Yeah. When did that start?
That's from the 90s.
Electricity.
Electricity? Okay. How about, is the Earth flat?
No.
It's round, all right.
Astronomy or something?
Well, somebody figure that out, the Earth isn't flat.
Magnetic energy?
Okay.
Is that ordering electricity?
Mm, they're kind of the same sort of thing. Although discovering the same thing, that was a discovery.
Were they discovered at the same time?
No. They were treated as independent phenomena. until
The incommensurability of straight lines and curves.
What do you mean?
I mean that Cooper's discovery regarding.
Well, don't poo poo everything by giving me a name. Come on, we're talking about discovery. Okay.
Well, okay. A discovery should be abstracted from the.
Should I tell you what to say, Charlie? Can you give me the script? Yeah. I must have not given
I'm
you.
Saying that.
So the line.
That. Things of what's the nature of being composed of straight lines are absolutely different than curves. You want me to show it?
No.
Yeah,
so lines are not curves.
The species distinctions.
Okay, well, yes. Anything else? Do you know which energy loss?
Energy is not created or destroyed.
Okay, so energy is conserved. Okay. How about how big the moon is?
Yeah.
People actually knew that before we got off the planet.
Andrew said atomic energy.
Why just the atoms?
Yeah, atoms. I had to figure out the atoms existed. Pretty good discoveries here.
The orbit of Ceres?
What's that?
The orbit of Ceres.
Okay.
That's astronomy, right?
Yeah. Okay, that's a specific thing.
Or the,
we're astronomy.
The heliocentric solar system.
Oh, so the sun's at the center. All right.
Yeah.
There's some time to do that.
That's probably enough of discoveries. The real question is, if you've been reading a fair amount of LaRouche, so don't answer this immediately.
What's common in we're using another discovery, figuring out how to make the notes of a scale. Pianos didn't just fall out of the sky. They figured out how to tune the things. The musical notes.
Refrigerator.
Mm-hmm. Refrigeration. Or I'll just write AC. Make it shorter. Same kind of concept they use. How did we? Anything that people know about kind of the method of how did people make these discoveries?
I know how they did.
They took down a lot of observations.
Okay, they made a lot of observations.
I had a question and they were trying to solve it.
Okay, so let's see, we got they observe things.
And they tried to answer it.
Okay, answering a question that they had posed themselves. Probably ask how they answered it, though. You got a quick question of, how do you go about solving something if you don't already know the answer?
Also, how they observed it.
How did you observe it?
Okay. You can observe it two different ways.
Okay. How did you do that? Because there's a lot of things you can observe about things. You could look at how long it did. You have to get what you're going to observe about it. That's true.
You have to have an idea first.
How do you mean?
Like, gravity. You have to have an idea of what it is, set out to prove it or disprove it.
Yeah, where does this idea of gravity even come from? Like, where did that idea first come into someone's head? How did that even happen?
Kepler didn't call it that.
Isaac.
No, but I mean, how did that idea come into somebody's head? An apple fell on somebody's head?
Mm-hmm.
Things fall? Well, that's what gravity does, but, I mean, people could just say things move downwards. And they move at this rate. The idea that things are actually, like, pulled, that everything is pulled to each other. Instead of just saying things on the earth go down, it's a little bit of a different thing to say. There was a time when people didn't think about the planets being pulled by gravity. Like, if you're to Copernicus, usually people say, Ptolemy said that the earth is at the center and the sun goes around the earth. And Copernicus said, no, the sun is at the center and the earth goes around the sun. He couldn't have told you why. He just said, that's how it goes. That's how my calculations worked out. How Oh, we made discoveries. People made discoveries? Like, have you worked through, like, redone, have you redone any of these experiments in school? Like, do you go through, like, how people first figured out the Earth was round, or where electricity came from, or how gravity was discovered, or how big the moon is? Mm-hmm. What'd you do in chemistry? Is it all just stuff about energy?
Well, actually, no, it's mass. Mass is conserved also. You did experiments of chemistry.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah, okay, and you weigh it before now.
Yeah.
So it's about mass being conserved.
Well, there's probably 2 points here. One is about our culture, and the other is about, you know, the epistemology of how did these things get made, because... I mean, who's done, like, real electrical or magnetic experiments in their lives?
Tony, what are you doing?
We were playing with these magnets with Larry Heck.
Oh, yeah.
These permanent magnets.
Mm-hmm.
That's powerful right. Magnets.
How about a connection between magnetism
anyways,
and electricity?
Well, isn't that what's demonstrated by this tube? That he slides the magnet down and it kind of floats.
Well, where is that concept, though? I mean, you see a magnet falling through tubes, so...
I don't know.
So, I mean, not really much done on this. You've probably done some motion stuff.
It has to take some energy to keep that... There has to be some form of energy
mm-hmm.
keeping that thing, like floating down rather than just, like, dropping.
Motion? Okay, you can put your mute on, you know. You've probably got a mute button on there. Not making a hint or anything. Motion. I mean, people done maybe a little bit, right? You know, maybe a few things in physics class, maybe threw a rock, saw where it landed. Gravity, I mean, forget about that. Like, as far as where the idea of gravity came from, no. The Earth is round. Does anybody here know the Earth is round? Except, I don't mean by flying and going around there. Okay. We've done the experiment.
Yeah. Right? It didn't work out. So I guess I don't know the Earth is round.
Who's even, like, tried doing an experiment to show the Earth is round?
It was stupid, though.
Before joining the LaRouche movement?
Oh, yeah.
Anybody before the Earth movement? What did you do?
It was stupid. Well, never mind. Forget it.
Sure. All right, so nobody...
I'll tell you later.
So nobody knows the Earth is round. I'm not really sure what to make this lines not curves thing. That seems a little bit... different. Energy is conserved. Does anybody know that?
Well, that was fundamental epistemological breakthrough.
We don't want to directly talk about epistemology here, per se.
Okay.
How about energy is conserved? Did anybody, like, do experiments with energy? What is energy anyway?
Yeah, I know. That's
all right. Everybody know how big the moon is and how far away it is?
250,000 miles.
256,000 miles.
How do you know that?
Sorry.
All right. No one knows how big the moon is, how far away it is.
It's
250,000 miles. How's
it's
that?
Like 2,000.
No, but how do you know? I mean, that's more.
Oh, okay.
Do you really know? I mean,
no,
you,
I don't know.
So no one's gone through atoms.
Of course.
I don't think any...
You can figure out how big the moon is.
But have you like, actually done experiments that demonstrate that atoms exist?
Where they...
mirrors on the moon and smaller than the element itself.
How did you go about... There's a few ways I was shown. How did you go about...
I mean, because... Well, I guess it's
the
periodic table
tells
you how much...
you can't look at the book first. We have to answer because someone had to figure out that periodic table at first, right?
Yeah.
So no one's really seen an atom
here.
All right. The orbit of Ceres. Has anybody discovered what the orbit of Ceres is?
Who
here has actually made observations of stars and planets and, like, written them down and actually plotted out where they go? Has anyone ever done that?
I have a telescope.
You have a telescope?
No, I don't. I like one.
Yeah, so no one's even done this.
Heard
this right. Musical notes. Has anyone, like, tried to figure out where the notes come from? Has anyone done that now?
Tries to figure out where the notes come from?
Outside of the LaRouche movement. I'm trying to get it.
Really.
So musical notes, you know, Lord knows. Anyone know how air conditioning works?
No.
You turn it on and it works.
You turn it on and free on. Does anybody know how the condensation stuff works?
It's like, I don't
AC, forget it. Mass is conserved. Okay, you've done some stuff on that, let's say. So we've done some stuff with this. Magnetism. The Earth goes around. Does anyone really know the Earth goes around the Sun?
I know the Earth goes around the Sun.
How do you know that?
How
do you know that?
I know, okay?
It's day and night.
Yeah, but maybe the Sun goes around the Earth. Do we really? I mean, have we actually gone through and made a discovery and said, I know for a fact the Earth goes around the Sun. I didn't just read about it. And gravity. Does anyone know where gravity came from? I mean, we've heard this thing about the apple on the head, you know?
I kind of have a sense of...
40,
I have some theories.
Do you know where gravity got discovered, and did you, have you gone through and redone the experiment, or redone the thinking involved?
Some of the thinking.
Let's say a little something here. So here are the greatest discoveries of mankind, what we think of just now. We don't know how any of them were made. Damn. How are we going to make more discoveries then? We're screwed, huh?
Maybe we'll find the answer in looking at how lines are not
off.
Okay.
Can
you do it?
Okay.
I used to think
that.
That
what?
Say again?
What did you used to think, Shauna?
You know?
What the hell's going on?
Hey, Shauna, could you find the mute button on your phone?
The cell phone.
Should we call you back? Oh, you can't find a charger? Can we just call you back wherever you are? Call the 800 number back. Call on the 800 number if you want to be on, okay? Alright, you know the number? Okay, 800-325. Well, are you in the 510 area code still? Alright, so 800. Yep, 8045. 325-8045. Mm-hmm. All right, got it. Her phone's dying. All right. Okay, so how? We don't know. It basically seems to be the consensus. Now, how is a civilization going to continue to reproduce itself and make a new generation of people who will understand how it works if we don't know how we figured anything out to get here in the first place? You're not gonna. And that's why we're in this situation that we're in, where the government's incompetent. I mean, we have a complete moron in the White House. Nothing against him particularly, but he is an idiot. And you've got, you know, some people you're bound to. We've all been through high school. None of this stuff, you know? So, that's why LaRouche's power, his clout, his influence does not come from having a lot of money or a fancy car, you know, with a cup holder and spinning rims and a GPS system or anything like that. He doesn't have a whole, you know, harem of women to entice, you know, people over, like, you know, Reverend Moon does, for example.
Ron Hubbard.
Well, he's got a method. They've just got a method, because here's another one. Here's another like discovery. The new economy doesn't work. Yeah, it's crashing right now. There's no job. The dollar's falling.
Is it really a discovery to find out something doesn't work?
Yeah. Some people figure out. People really know why it doesn't work.
Does it have anything to do with idea? Prozac?
Were there a lot of people, based on, you know, were there a lot of people saying this in 1971? Because LaRouche was. After this change in 1971, he said, we have created a financial system that won't work, and it will fall apart if we don't change it. He didn't say it's going to happen next week or anything. That's what's happening right now. We've had 30 years of just kind of coasting along, trying to enjoy ourselves and have a fancy, you know, big party and some fancy stuff and some fun stuff to have around and get your Viagra on you. But nothing fundamental in terms of what's required to maintain human civilization. So, actually, a big part about, I mean, the way these discoveries are made, which is just not in education anymore, it's not about observations. You got to observe things. If you got no eyes, you're going to have a hard time, you know, discovering a lot about art, you know. But discoveries are not from the observations. Take an example of, how about the Earth being brown? That's a fun one. Let's take this for a bit. The way this happened was there was a Thales, or the guy's name. Oh, Eratosthenes, right?
Mm-hmm.
Someone. They did was they went to two places.
Over here.
In Egypt. There, I think by Alexandria. And then down here by actually they already got dots on them. Up here by this dot by Alexandria, and then almost straight south, there's a place in Sudan. And what he found out was that there is a well that on a certain day of the year in Egypt. If you look down the well, there was no shadow on it. like the light, the earth, the sun was completely overhead. So if you look down, you know, it was just the light went all the way down to the bottom and reflected on the water. It wasn't kind of, you know, it wasn't kind of cut off. You know, if you feel light at an angle, you know, some of it's going to hit the wall here and it's not going to get in. But here, it went straight down all the way. And when he was over here, down in Sudan, he put up a stick that same day of the year. So he did was he did that, you know, 1 year he was in Egypt. The next year, he's like, I'm going to make my way down to Sudan next year. So he's in Sudan. He's measured how far south he's gone to get down to Sudan. And we got the earth here. So we got... So Egypt is... Egypt's about here, so... And you got Egypt. And you got Sudan. So what it means that the sun went straight into the well in Egypt, is right there the sun is, you know, it's like, and the sun's so big, it's like all the light's coming out like this. It's like a big flashlight or something. So right here in Egypt, the light went straight into the well, which was, you know, presumably dug straight down. What he did, the guy did in Sudan, was he put up a stick. It wasn't that tall or anything, but he put up a stick, and he saw how far the shadow was that it made on the earth. And it was different in the two places. It went straight down in Egypt, but over here, there's a paradox. It wasn't the same. The sun was not coming straight down. It made a shadow if you held up a stick. If you held a stick straight up in Egypt, no shadow. You know, it would just go, it was coming right down on the stick, directly over your head. So what he figured out from this was, since he knew how far this distance was, and he knew what the angle was that was being made here, I don't know if any of us all get the exact work behind it, but he was able to determine, okay, actually it's pretty simple. You know what the angle was here, between where the shadow was and where the top of the stick was? That's the same as the angle here. So he could know how much of the earth he'd walked through. You know, what portion of the whole earth he'd walked south. And he knew how far he walked. So you put that together and you could say, well, how far is it, how big is the whole earth? He didn't get off the planet. He didn't go that far. He didn't, you know, take a ship all the way around the world. He went, you know, I don't know, how far is it? 1,000 miles or something like this, or 400 miles, I don't even know. Now that's something you could do in school. I mean, you could even just do it. You could find a school somewhere else in the country that's directly north or south of you, and you could measure the angles, and all the kids could discover how big the earth is. But you're not going to figure it out by looking down on the earth where you are. Or the question of gravity came again, not from observations. Because people who made observations came with a number of different answers. One of these people, Ptolemy, let's call him P, said the earth is at the center and everything goes around. We got the sun around the earth. We had Copernicus. They say we had the Copernican Revolution, when everything was changed. People believe that the sun was at the center and the earth goes around it. They take a flashlight out in school and move the ball around and they say, look, you know, the earth goes around the sun. You don't prove it with a flashlight. So Copernicus said that. There was another man, a guy from Denmark, who was, he made a lot of observations, because he was royal, he didn't have anything to do, so when he wasn't partying, he would, you know, he really, he liked astronomy, he made hundreds of thousands and millions of observations. And he said something else, he said the earth is at the center, the moon goes around the earth, the sun goes around the earth, and do you know where he said the planets are, the rest of the planets?
The outside.
He said they go around the sun. Look at this crazy system he came up with. That was with the most observation. It shows if you're looking at things the wrong way, and you look at it a lot the wrong way, it doesn't help you figure out the right way to look at things. You know, if you're lost in the woods, and you're inspecting something really close, but you're just completely lost, it's not going to help you to find out what side of the tree the moss is growing on or something. So what all these guys missed something pretty simple. It's a question of epistemology of what is reality. Because these guys all thought that the reality was just what they saw, and describing what they saw. Like someone saying, the stock market is going up, therefore the new economy is successful. Somebody said, look, the dollar is being, you know, I can buy shoes cheaper now thanks to free trade, therefore that's a good system. Or even somebody in a rich neighborhood saying, hey, everything's fine, look, the economy is doing great, my neighbor just got, you know, 2 new Hummers. You know, I heard the hospital downtown shut down, but whatever, I don't go there. I'm sure they made a new one.
Well, what are these guys on this? Do you have an idea what none of these guys were asking? An idea?
How?
Charles, do you have an idea?
How the guy who didn't eat the thing made the discovery?
Well, now we're talking about how the planets move, and the sun and the earth and all this. We presented three different ways of thinking about it. People made observations, they came up with three different systems. But one other thing, you could ask any three of these guys, where's Jupiter going to be in 2 months? And they'll all tell you, they'll all be right. They'll all tell you where Jupiter's going to be, even though they're all different. So do you know what they're missing? They're missing reality. Because, think about it, there's probably planets all over the universe. And if you just try to look at each one of the solar system, whatever, you got to figure out, you know, how are things moving? You look at each one individually and you analyze and you make an equation for how it moves. You're missing something very fundamental and universal, which is, why do planets move? Why do they just stay put? Why do they have to go around moving in the first place? You know? Why don't they just fly off? Why are they staying around the sun? If they're around the sun, why do they like the sun so much? Why aren't they just going off somewhere else? Are they on a big hoop? Is there a big metal hoop that they're stuck on or something like that? They're in a racetrack and just going around in a big circle? No, none of them ask, why are they doing that? So there's a man named Kepler. A guy in Germany. He asked why. And the discovery of the principle of gravitation came from Kepler. And he's trying to figure out, why did these planets move anyway? What is it that's pulling them around? What is it that holds them in? And that's where gravitation came from. You see, it's something outside your observations. The idea of gravity, you don't see gravity. You don't see gravity in the motions of the planets. You guys see all sorts of things, so it's always not something you see. Kepler didn't even have very good eyesight. He had to use a lot of Tycho Brahe's observations. He couldn't really, he couldn't see that well. So, that's the center of... I'm going through this this distinction between information, because look, we've got an information academy now, right? We've got all sorts of information. You know, we know what the stocks are at, we can do day trading, we can buy stocks, you know, and then sell them 10 minutes later, make a little bit of money because we heard a tip from, you know, the gossip column while we were chatting with our friends, instant messaging somebody else and downloading something somewhere. We're supposed to make money doing that, but what information misses is how to make a discovery. So if you overload yourself with a bunch of information, that doesn't help you learn anything. It doesn't help you know why anything happens. And the fun thing is if you know why something happens, you can use the principle that's causing it to happen, and you can use it as a tool. You can use it somewhere else. So if you use, for example, if you use things about atoms, you can create new technologies. If you figure out how to actually make a musical instrument, you can make beautiful music. You can figure out how to tune keys. You can make things that really... You can make music that's really the same thing as making a discovery. We can music some other time. But that's what LaRouche has got. He's got a method. And the center of undoing the terrible education that we've got, which is there's two big things that are wrong with the education. One is that we think we know things that we don't know. I believe it, I heard it, you know. There's these things called points. I've never seen a point. Have you ever actually seen a point, something infinitely tiny, with no mass, a point, like in geometry class? Or you got these lines. Who on earth had something that was completely straight? Where do you find that in the world? Then you got planes. There's nothing flat. Everything that looks flat, they got little dents in it. If you look at it really big, it gets curved. The Earth looks pretty flat. Then it looks flat. Yeah. So you start thinking you know things that just aren't true. Like, the rich are just going to keep getting richer. We can't do anything about it. Or the war is inevitable. Or George Bush will just cheat in the next election. What do you can't do anything about it? You can't do anything about it, you know? People are just mean and nasty. You know, what are you going to do? Hey, you know, they just can't get along. Who knows any of these things? Who has a principled reason that they absolutely know for sure generates any of those things? You don't. So one of them is that, and the other thing is, how do you make a discovery? How do you really come to know something that's real? Because human civilization depends on our ability as a generation to master the ability to make new discoveries. Or civilization won't survive.
Our whole economy is based on discoveries. If we don't know how to use the principles that we've discovered anymore, we can't keep trains running. We can't keep hospitals open. We can't train doctors. We can't run power plants. We can't do anything. We can't even keep crops being grown properly. If you start losing the ability to know how agriculture works, how plants operate, the science behind them, behind plants. So this, what LaRouche has said is that the way to build a youth movement, the way to build a big political youth movement is not to hand out free Viagra. Well, obviously it's a youth movement. It's not to hand out free medical marijuana. Maybe not obviously, but we're not going to hand out free medical marijuana, have harems, pay people a lot of money. He said, nope. The center of it is going to be the method of a man named Carl Friedrich. I'm curious if people have heard of him outside of... Have you heard of Gauss outside of these meetings? Or have you heard of this man named Carl Friedrich Gauss? Yeah. This guy is known by mathematicians as the Prince of Mathematics, the best mathematician ever. No one ever reads anything that he takes. I mean, that he's written. What's that? I don't know, maybe King was too high. I don't know, math is called the queen of the sciences, but if it had a prince, it doesn't have a king, I don't know. Maybe. Hey, whatever. So this is a guy named Gauss. He did the same thing that we've got to do today, because when he came on the scene, it wasn't just the state of mathematics, it was the state of everything in Europe at his time. He just recently had the French Revolution, which was a mess. They're beheading scientists all over the place. Napoleon was, by the time he wrote a very specific paper that that LaRouche refers to, in 1799, this is just shortly before Napoleon came into power. You know, the dictator, the fascist, who tried to conquer all of Europe and failed. This is the time period that he lived in. And what he did as a mathematician was he, not as a mathematician, as a human being, was he brought back the idea of discovering things through the paradox and through things that don't work. And so, actually, I don't even know what, I'm not sure how much time I have. How much time do I have, Charlie?
What time is it?
I don't know. It's 8:55. It's hot. Is that ACR? Which one ACR?
It's 9, almost 5 to 9.
I don't know, keep going, I suppose. The, Carl Gauss wrote a, can we turn AC on, though? Carl Gauss wrote a paper on something that's called the fundamental, so here we go, another fundamental thing, which we probably never learned. The fundamental theorem, you know, the title's scary here. The fundamental theorem of algebra. Which actually is not even about algebra or about mathematics or anything like that. It's about going back to the method of making discoveries. So, actually, one good thing, I'm going to have someone else do this, actually, is, you seen this before in school? Remember the Pythagorean theorem, right? Mm-hmm. You got the 3-4-5 triangle going on and all this stuff.
That makes lots of sense.
Seen that before?
I hate that.
Did you ever go through where it came from?
No.
Did you ever go through like how someone actually discovered this equation? It's for triangles. It says the short one of the sides. You take the length and you square it and multiply it by itself. So 3 squared is 9. 4 squared. 4 times 4 is 16. And 5. 5 squared is 25. I said, well, look, 9. Plus 16 is 25. They say that's true for any triangle. It's got a right angle on it. It's got a square angle on it. Can someone show why that's true? Anybody? Mm-hmm. But does it always work out that way? Plus, the most important thing is where does it come from? Not just does it work. Because, you know, going to work, getting a job, that might work for years as far as you being able to pay your bills and do all right. But overall, civilization is not going to survive. Because, meanwhile, while you're doing that, George Bush just got elected president. You know? So just because things work, you know, it looks like they work. It doesn't mean it really... anybody? Anybody know how to do this? Ricky, you got it?
Yes, but I have to.
Somebody's got to do it.
Go through something.
Well,
it's from Well, we're just going to go with some axioms. If you're talking about squares, a squared plus b squared plus c squared, obviously there has to be some kind of square involved, right? I don't think they'd use the word square if they weren't talking about squares. So let's just say this is a square of a, square of b, and the square of c. So this is length b, a, c. So we have a short leg, somewhat longer leg, and the hypotenuse. And so we have to prove, using these squares, right, like it says in the formula, that adding these two squares will create this square. Which would actually make this triangle.
What do you mean it would actually make that triangle?
It would make this correct.
You mean it would make a square?
Because you'd know for a fact that if you add these two, you're going to get this.
Okay.
And any ideas? Charles?
Do we add?
Too late.
How much is A? I need like a number, like just a letter.
Doesn't matter how much it is. It's supposed to work with any triangle.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. Any right triangle. Any triangle with a maybe for you.
Well,
that's why.
I don't know. I think people should work on it.
No, we have to go and do it. Make the example of the discovery.
Okay.
Right?
All right.
Does anybody have any idea? Do you have any idea?
What?
How to solve this? How to prove that a squared plus b squared equals c?
How to plug in any number?
No number.
Numbers.
Maybe just that one thing worked.
Yeah, you got to prove it.
You got to prove it geometrically.
That these, because they're like a squared is a square. If you have a square with a on each side, you know, a by a, it's a squared. So we got to somehow know that no matter what would be the triangle like, this square, and you add on the area that's squared to it, would be the same size as this square. That's what the question is. So it's not about numbers at all, it's about triangles.
You could, solve for one of the letters, like C, and then whatever you get, plug that into where C is, and see if it comes
but
out.
Then won't you just get a whole bunch of other things?
You get A equals A.
No, if you did that, you could just write A squared plus B squared, and say, look, A squared plus B squared is A squared plus B squared. But he didn't really show anything.
No.
So how is it some ballet with
what
the numbers
can we
danced
actually,
around
what
it?
Can we,
yeah, I don't think
what
you
can we draw
anything without numbers.
What can
you
can
draw the little boxes and you could add them up.
Wait,
but you don't have
okay.
boxes and you don't
well,
have numbers.
I think we should go and we go with the doubling of the square.
No. Very good.
What
the
about Carl? The ideas, Carl?
You've done this before, Carl?
I've seen it.
You've seen it.
Yeah.
Oh. How about Ryan?
You're on the spot. you got an idea or a hint to give Ricky? I can progress?
Mm-hmm. I don't really know. Sometimes. No. Well, you can fill in some of the blanks here because there are things that we know out of this. We can know that each one of these sides is an A. I know that all of these sides are B. And all of these sides are C. That's something that I didn't know wasn't clear.
Two people.
You got an idea, Charles?
Nope.
I don't get what you're asking.
We can prove, we need to prove that if you were to add these squares, you'd get this square.
You could,
right?
You could double the square first, actually.
Yeah.
You can leave that up to another draw.
Okay. Well, look. This requires a geometric construction. So we're going to look at another somewhat simpler geometric problem. Just to give you an example, or people an example here, how to prove things geometrically. Now, do you think you can make this is a square as area is known. Do you think you can construct from this square, or using these squares as a unit, a square is area is 2?
A what?
Do you think you can construct using these squares, these squares
square.
As area is 1? But I'm saying this is what you know, right? So you can use these. Construct a square from this, off this, a square whose area is 2.
A square that's area is 2?
Yeah. This is 1, right? You want to double. You know it, huh? No?
No, you don't know it?
Man. Alright.
You want to take a pen? Give it a shot.
Who wants to try it first? You want to try it first?
Both sides equal to root 2.
But where does that
math major? This is where symbols and numbers again.
And I changed it.
Don't you cut in half? Like split it?
Well, you can cut it in half, but you want to double it. So
yeah. Cut it in half and stick them together, and you get 4. Triangles,
mm-hmm.
And they all
got
together in like 1 square.
Wait, what did you say?
that sounds like a good idea.
I don't know.
Good shot.
I'm just saying. So you can use, how many of these can you use?
As many as you want.
Okay,
but
if you have 2 of them, and you cut them in half, and then you stick those all together, and then you have these. And that'd be that'd be like
1/2,
that'd equal 2.
All right. Yeah. So yeah.
Is that right?
Yeah.
Oh, cool.
But even though we were looking for the other, but let me just, you're right, you're correct.
Okay, so now let's let's apply that principle of Pythagorean theorem.
Well, that kind
of
showed the Pythagorean theorem a little bit, actually. Remember you said that this ought to be the square root of 2, the side of the square?
Yeah.
Totally even. Well, all right.
Alright, so that was a geometric construction. Did you see how that was a geometric construction? What she did was...
Can we get a square? Can we get 8? Drew, can you cut out a couple squares for us?
I know, square.
Oh, he's out.
Maybe we get some beauty rest. But the square, where does that...
You know that this is a square as area is 4.
Yeah.
And so if you were to cut that in half, you know that you get a square root of 0 is 2. And that's really where you get square root of 2. So that's where this comes from.
So far.
Oops. So you're not a... It's not just like a symbol. They really were talking about squares. So now, what kind of geometric construction can you construct from this?
Okay.
Why don't you just try something?
Yeah, give it a shot.
Just try some.
Try to. What you did was conceptually try to kind of work off this a little bit.
I don't know. I have no idea.
Well, one thing you might say is put B inside C and see if the area left is A.
Oh, yeah.
Do that, Ricky. See how that works.
Well, how would we put B into C? And know exactly how much area is left.
Because you could do, if you took this length here, you just put the same length up here, and then you put the length B up there. And you know how long B is, so you just make a little square, and you can have a B square inside the C. That's the B square.
But then how do you know?
I don't know how you know if that's the same as A squared, huh? I'm sure it is.
I'm sure I know how to do heart surgery.
Yes, yeah. I read about it in a book.
No, I don't know.
What do we know about the ABC triangle? That's a triangle, it's ABC, right? That's
right.
Oh.
John?
Charles, what do you know about the ABC triangle?
That damn thing.
It's everywhere.
You can just pad the C. I mean.
What? It's everywhere.
What
here. Show us where it is.
All over the place. What are the sides?
Everywhere in life.
Okay, if it's A and B here, there's A and B here, and they're the same, you can just say that it's like C right here.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And if you project this over here, you can say, okay, we got an A, and we got a B.
Alright.
So look. Triangles, right? And if you have a C,
you might want to redraw that C square. I mean, it is good to have that a pretty good square.
Why? What's is it this
part
crooked?
Yeah.
It's just where is it here? It's starting to do percent by the board, I think.
Well, I can see that this is a C and this is a C. So you can kind of like foot B up that way. And if it's A, B and C, then you just say this is A. And if it's here and here, then it's here and here too, because it's like they're squares and triangles and they're the same.
See, this is hard when it's not really drawn right. This is actually the debate. That's a joke.
Oh, it's actually.
Mm-hmm. Force it to flash. Doesn't the shadows meet the spaces? I just don't know.
All right. Now. Now, if you were to just do one big thing, okay. Now, do people see? Now, do people see how a squared plus b squared equals c squared yet?
The last one you wrote isn't right.
This one?
Yeah. I mean, it does help to draw really well.
Yeah.
Those are upside down in the wrong letters.
Oh, really? I still don't get it.
It's still upside down. Anyway.
Oh.
That's A to B.
Okay.
Okay. Sigma. Sigma. Theta. G. Beta. Theta.
Q in a row.
Epsilon. Whatever. Okay, do you guys see now how A squared plus B squared equals C squared?
I don't see it in that picture.
Well,
Just get the thing out of the trunk. Little.
Well, if you... Actually, that wasn't too important. If you can... These four... You know that these four triangles are the same as these four. And so... They actually end up creating the same square, these two, right? And you know that they're going to leave the same amount of space when you put them together in the same perimeter, right? And so that's how you know that this remaining space is the same as this remaining space. You see? Because you have these four. You're using the same four kinds of triangles.
How do you know the two big squares are the same?
Well, you know that because you're... The triangles are... Form the same sides, right?
Well, how big are the big squares? What is the size?
A, B.
A, B's.
Yeah. So that's how you know the side of the squares in this case. So that's how you know. As opposed to believing the Pythagorean theorem. What do you think?
I like just believing the Pythagorean theorem.
So, everyone should...
Was this satisfying? Is that satisfying? Did that work all right?
No, not really, but it's all right.
No, it's not all right.
We'll just keep trying to.
So you have you see what they did? They use these triangles to go outside the box, so to speak. Because if, this is the problem with the way they teach mathematics and everything, is they don't teach you to actually look beyond anything you see with your senses or experience with, with your simple memorization and things like this. You had to actually, looking at the triangle and the two squares, there's no way you could have just like tried to fit it in there. You had to look beyond just the triangle and the two squares. So what Ricky had done is, and Jonathan, is they said, okay, well, let's use the triangle to create new squares. And you ended up creating two all-new squares that encompass the other three squares. And they're saying that improving these new larger squares to be equal squares, that is this square right here, right? This square right here to be equal and to both use the same number of triangles in the creation of the square, then you can therefore prove that this square plus this square equals this square.
Oh, I see now. Now I see.
And you do that because when you reorganize the triangles, you end up with two squares that are A plus B squared.
And then you have
four,
doesn't it?
A plus B squared, and they're both A plus B squared. You can demonstrate that they're both. You okay?
No, I'm okay. Yeah. No, I
didn't. So that's what you can prove. You can show that you can show that each of them have four squares. Like, or four triangles, and you just take away the triangles, and you have, you know, you have solution. You can know it's true, and you can know it's true for any. You can do this construction for any triangle. Well, any right triangle will always work. That's how you can know it.
Because it didn't matter how what this right triangle looked like per se. We didn't use anything special about this particular right triangle. We didn't measure the size.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. We just said all we know is it's a right triangle, and then look, we did this.
So,
okay. So now this is, well, this is our university. We've got our own combat university on wheels, as we call it, because we've got to go out. Well, we've got to, what this has to do with a presidential campaign, because this is a president, LaRouche is running for president, you know, this isn't like, you know, math class or something. If you're going to be able to change a population that right now is sitting on the behinds, watching their rights being taken away, they just saw their nation bomb Iraq, and you know that, I imagine that was big. You know, people are like, I can't believe we're really doing this. We're not going to do that. And now what's going on? People going to movies, same old again. You feel a little bit disquieted. So what you got to do to get into that, there's a bunch of things. One of these things is demonstrating that, look, people think they know things they don't. So people think all sorts of things about politics they don't know. And this is very useful for going after that, this thing with the lines and the points, and do you even really know that a squared plus b squared is c squared? Other things like that. You can ask people, you know, what's this? But what is it? What is the square root of negative one? What?
I.
You are?
You're no, th- I. No, I.
I. It's another symbol. What does that mean?
It's an imaginary number, but to me it doesn't mean anything.
Exactly. And it didn't mean anything to the mathematicians before Gauss either. They said, because what they're doing is they're looking at all sorts of equations they're making up. Like they were, let's go through quickly where algebra came from. Because it did not come from symbols. Once again, it came from something real. Like everything that we get is just garbage. They take off, they clean off, they scrape off every bit of a real discovery in anything. They just give you, you know, algebra. And where'd it come from? Who knows? They never tell you, for example. It came from an Arab person, actually, Al-Khwarizmi. Wrote a book on algebar, which actually means putting back together. Let me give you a real quick example of this. Like, you've probably seen things like, I always use the same example. Here you go. How about that? No, not 36. 55. 8. 8? Does 8 work? 3? No, 3's not so good.
8? 9.
How about 24? Okay. Is that all right? 24 over here. Okay. Now, what does that mean anyway? Some symbol with a 2 above it, plus 10 symbol equals 24. What does that even mean anyway? It came from looking at things in terms of, this is actually harder than the overhead.
Good shot, Steve.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, that's right. Okay. Yeah, everyone see that. We got a bag of high-tech math stuff here.
You're gonna get splinters.
I'll be fine. They just don't, like, you know, they don't kill you. It's getting a little bit. Like, for example, like, 3. Like, well, first of all, if you're gonna think about number, you have to have an idea of what 1 is. You know, because, like, 1 what? Like, what are you talking about? So, if you get an idea of number, say 3, for example, well, we tripled it. We did it, you know, we had 3 of them. If you want to say what's 3 times 3, for example, we got 3 sitting there. Well, let's do 2 of them. And let's do 3 of them. It's 3 times 3, it's 9, you know. You can play around. Like, you can see, like the reason these things are called square numbers, is, I mean, don't just assume it means a number times a number. Where'd that come from? You know, like, here, can you make that into a square?
Let's start small. That's a square, I suppose, right?
Yeah.
How'd that? Make a square out of that?
No. Yes. No. Yeah. No. Keep going. One more. Okay.
Okay.
No.
They're called square numbers. You make squares.
Yeah.
That's what squaring is. Do something, and you have a square that I'm doing that on two sides. That's why squaring is like something times itself, because that's what makes a square.
So we've got this question up here. X squared plus 10x is 24. X is just means we just don't know what it is yet. So say we've got a square. X on each side. Fair enough, right? That's X squared. What does 10x look like? Chops this in half into two pieces here, and he puts the halves on the outside of the square. So that's five on the side, right? Because it's cut in half. We're going to do it with the actual blocks right there, too. So. You guys can maybe like come over here or something. I'm going to just put the chair up. Here's the 10x before.
What?
We're putting it around the x squared.
A dollar.
What's in my wallet?
Now I've got a big hole in the middle, huh? All right. This is what algebra means, restoring or fixing. So he said he took some algebra and he filled in this hole here. So this is 24. So that's the question is. So if we fill in this hole here, we have to add that many over here also, right?
Stay in here,
to be fair. So let's go ahead and see how many we have to add in. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Yeah, we should go back here. 11, 12, 13. 18, 19, 20, is that enough yet? Let's see. 1, 2, 3, 4, oh, I took 25. Now I made a nice big square. So, get that in 25 here. And we have to add 25 to whatever it's supposed to equal to, right? And 24 plus 25 is 49.
Oh, so we know.
So we've got a square that's 49 on each side. How many? You got an area of 49. How many blocks is it going to be on each side?
Oh,
it's
7.
Well, this is 7 on each side. I was this guy cheating. I knew it was going to be. I knew it was right in the beginning.
But you could, just because I knew we were using blocks, but it works just fine. So you say, okay, 49, it's 7 on each side, right? So I mean, since these things are equal, this is also 7, right? So how big is x? Let's
split up a little bit here if you want to look at it.
So you, did you ever do completing the square in algebra class? Mm-hmm. And you just do, well, that's where the square that you're completing comes from. It actually means something real. In math class, they just say divide this into, square it, and then add it to both sides.
Yeah.
And that's why. So this is where algebra came from. What happened was that you had these algebraists who were looking at these things saying, okay, well, I can ask all sorts of questions with these things. You know, I can look at all sorts of rectangles and squares and things like this. And they said, well, let me ask myself a question. Let's see what I can do. What if I said x squared plus 2 equals 1? Wait a minute, how's that going to work?
It's not possible.
How do you have something and you add 2 more to it and you wind up with 1 when you're done? This has got to be some number eating thing. So let's say we got negative numbers. Let's say we can imagine, you know, negative. What?
Square.
Why is that, for starters?
I don't know.
Well, see, the thing you got to think about, there's another way to think about this besides just in terms of, like, areas. But you can think of, and what does negative mean? Like, let's say you're talking about feet. When you're measuring how long something is, what does negative feet mean?
That's not possible. I mean, that's, you have less than 12 feet.
Well, it just means it's that many feet in the other direction, right?
Oh.
That's all it means. Okay. So if this is positive, and you make it negative, then you do the negative again, negative squared. That just means you're going forward again.
Yeah.
That's why negative times a negative is positive. So, you know, you get positive, you get negative, but we want something times itself that gives a negative 1, right? That's the question that Gauss took up. Because the problem with the mathematicians of his day, like today's economists, like people, generally in our culture, is they just look at what they can see. And they say, I have no idea. I'll just say x is the square root of negative 1. And I know that's really impossible, so I'm going to go ahead and just call it I, because, you know, that's impossible. It can't really be. So I'm gonna there's something that I even admit to doesn't really exist, and I'm going to use it. Isn't that crazy?
Yeah.
Here's something I know doesn't make any sense, but I'm going to do it anyway. That's nuts. It's nuts. So what Gauss... And I think we're not going to go through all of it. We're going to be doing this again. Come back tomorrow night. We're going to be going through Gauss's paper tomorrow night. Because what he does is he really just takes these guys apart. He says, these guys run into problems. They're trying to prove some things about equations. And it's really interesting. They wind up in a jam. They can't do it. Because they're using these magical things. They don't know where it came from. Gauss actually explains what this really is. And it has a meaning that you can't see, per se. It's not a number of feet that way. It's not a number of feet that way. But it's still there. I'll give you an example to understand this real quick. Maybe that'll be it. But let's say if you've got like a, you know, bathtub, and you go splash, you splash, you get the waves going up and down, and it goes throughout the bathtub. Let's say you had a bathtub like this, you know, and splash, and then you get a little wave going on. That'd be a pretty big wave in your bathtub. But you could say, you know, how tall is the wave right here, right? And you have a certain number of inches, right? You have some plus number of inches. Here you've got some negative number of inches, right? The way of doing right there. You don't see it doing anything, but the wave still has a power right there, right? So it's not like it's not like there's really no wave there. It's about to just start moving, right? So the square root of negative 1 is hiding in there. Basically, it's a metaphor for any kind of a discovery. It's the same thing as gravity. You don't see gravity, but it's acting. The square root of negative 1 might not make a shadow that you can see, but the wave is still there. In fact, this is where the wave is its most powerful. This is where it's changing the most. Up here, the wave is just kind of sitting up at the top. It's not doing much. And speeds up and goes zoom, and shoots down. So right here, the wave's gotten most of its power, but you don't see it at all. Gauss goes through a beautiful, this paper is just beautiful, where he actually elaborates, where is this thing hiding? Where physically is this hiding? The same way as, like, a lot of people, infrastructure, energy systems, water, hospitals, those are all imaginary numbers.
I know we need him, but hey, I'm not sick. You know, who needs it? Whatever.
No, those are the real things. Or discoveries, the act of discovery, something you can't see. But it's the real power behind an economy. You don't make any discoveries, you're dead. The universe is going to kill you. You just sit around having fun in your SUV with your spinning rims, you know? You're not making your you're not making new chemical refineries to make your gasoline or plastic plants or steel factories or engineers or any of that. You're just sitting playing in your car. So, anyway, we're working on this. It's beautiful. And that is that's the center of the youth movement, of the LaRouche youth movement, is to be able to, because if you go through and you can demonstrate this, if you have the ability to go through, this, we just did some stuff, it can be done better. But even demonstrating people an ability to make discoveries they didn't even know they had, because we never make any. Remember, we crossed off the whole list practically. That's economics. Because it's that process of making discoveries that changes our relationship to nature, which is what makes it different from animals. That's an exciting thing to be able to go out and tell people. And we got to do it. Well, Charlie's going to go into why we got to do it, what the political situation is right now. So, well, I don't know, are there any questions, actually? We probably just came up as we went along, but... Questions about cars? Viagra side effects? The downsides of using too much medical marijuana?
You get that.
Those are Prozac and all those things are good.
What's
discovery.
That?
When all the Prozac and things are good discoveries.
Well, the thing is, that think about how these things get used. It's like, they're imaginary numbers, really. Well, I can't just call everything an imaginary number. But we have a lot of problems, and we have a messed up, this screwed up culture right now. Schools are terrible, kids are shooting each other, more and more homeless people can't find jobs. When you do have a job, it's, you know, doing what, working at McDonald's or being a stockbroker? Nothing really useful. I mean, you know, people can make their own hamburgers, you know, nothing against people at McDonald's, but, you know, it's not a mark of a really successful economy to have a bunch of, you know, Wendy's around or something like that. So, I mean, it would make sense to get a little depressed looking at that.
Yeah.
And now you could fix it, or you could take a pill and pretend it's not there, but it really is there. So even if you're making yourself feel better, you're just kidding yourself, you know? If you get some sort of problem or whatever, you're not going to actually work it through. You're not going to remove the cause of it just by getting rid of the effects. Like, you know, Tylenol doesn't cure anything. It just makes you not feel the pain. You know, Tylenol is not—it's not insulin. It's not penicillin. It's not CAT scans or MRIs or catheters or any of that. It just, you know, we just got Tylenol for the mind now. That's all it is. It's nothing really great. So.
I got a question. Do you think Lynn's, I guess, his dream or his hope or what he plans to do? Do you think that would cut down on all of these psychotropic drugs, you know, like, Prozac and whatnot? Because we have those little polemics that, you know, where we have the cure for depression and it's not Prozac.
Yeah, you wouldn't need all this stuff. I mean, it's being used by millions and millions of people right now, and we should just actually fix the problems we've got. Mm-hmm. I'm not sure you'd have reason to be happy in a world that's going on the right track. I mean, we're developing a space program to go to Mars. Visit the moon again. We haven't been there in 30 years. If in the news you hear about the latest hospital that was just built in Namibia, or the links, that they finally completed the link between Russia and Alaska across the Bering Straits, and the first train's going to go through the tunnel the next day. You know, the presidents of both countries are going to be on board.
Hmm.
Or a breakthrough in the quest for a cure for cancer. Or, you know, developing the Middle East. And putting in a water desalination plant to make tons of fresh water to fight the desert instead of each other. And if that's in the news all the time, all these little problems you might have had about how your dog died 5 years ago and you still haven't gotten over it, you know, I mean, you know, you might not need the Zoloft anymore. You might just say, wow, things are going good, you know. I got to use, you know, and other substances too. You know, you might cut the LSD when the world's actually exciting, you know, and you realize, wait, I can't understand what's going on if I keep putting this stuff in my body. I go crazy. So, yeah.
A lot of times I get depressed because men suck. So, I mean, I don't think...
You mean human beings or men?
Some men just suck. So, I mean, I don't know.
Harsh.
I said some, not all.
Yeah. But you said they just suck. That's just them. They just suck.
well.
Okay. This is all stuff any human being could do, and we could all be doing it, so.
Yeah. I get what you're saying.
We're right about everything.
Say that again, Ricky?
This is empirical proof that we're right about everything.
Oh yeah, that's on tape.
All the spirals and the geometry.
No, it's
wow.
Not green light.
Yes, it is. Look at that.
120 degrees.
Yeah, no, the camera's 120 degrees, and you see you got a triangle. See, check these three things out. Yeah, this is three hands, three fingers.
We're not gonna have seizures, are we?
Right. We put it like this, but there's gonna be four of them. Yeah, look at that. See, four of them.
Because we are mastering the universe.
Let me play. Oh,
pentagons.
Oh, yeah, look, five fingers.
Oh
that's
man,
crazy.
Now there's six, but where does the sixth one come from? It just kind of appears. And when we cut a circle in seven, we defied the universe.
Ooh, now we can prove we can create a
wait,
seven.
Does this need to get recorded?
So create some spirals.
Well, I mean, I should put your class on it, then we can play with it. This is on the same tape your class is going to be on. You want this big gap in before your
but this
briefing?
This could be the beginning. This could be like the introduction music.
I want to watch this forever.